So in 1959, our family moved to Los Angeles, land of sunshine, palm trees, and movie stars. Now, my dad loved to eat out. This was his passion. And he finally had enough money to take us to some classy restaurants. And as a kid, I was just amazed by the shiny white tablecloths, the chandeliers, the elegant waiters. And as soon as we were seated, Dad would start to entertain Tom and me. He might start with a little sleight of hand. He'd go, "Okay, kids, now watch, 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 watch." Wow! Our favorite restaurant was the Villa Capri. A lot of movie stars came in there. Dad was kind of shy, and he didn't approach too many of them, but sometimes they'd approach him because he was famous now, too. He was still shy, though. Oh, I remember one time Frank Sinatra came in. Dad leaned in and explained that he was part owner of the restaurant. Frank came in with his usual panache, his trench coat over the shoulder. He looked over and saw the three of us staring at him, and he did the most amazing thing. He went, "Don, Don, 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 baby. I'm such a fan of yours. Then again, I'm a fan of anyone who's skinnier than I am." And then I saw my first movie star. It was Marilyn Monroe. And she recognized him. She said, "Oh, it's Mr. Limpet. Oh, tell me, are you still a fresh fish? Oh, Donnie, you're so cute. Oh." And I remember, oh, thank you. Thank you. I remember thinking, my father's cute? And another time, we had just walked in the front door of the restaurant, and there was a beautiful lady standing there wearing a white feather boa. And I said, "Daddy, who's that?" He went, "Shh, that's Carol Channing." Carol? She turned around and went, "Oh, it's Don Knotts, Don. You know, when I was doing Hello, Dolly, everybody talking to me about Dolly, Dolly, Dolly. And when I was on the Steve Allen show, everybody said, don't talk to Don Knotts because he's Dell. They said he's Mr. Dell. Well, I'm not going to call you Hello, Dolly. I'm going to call you Hello, Donnie, because I think you're wonderful." Oh, these stars, they just love to make entrances and exits, and whenever they would do that, Dad would turn to us kids and make a face, you know, like he couldn't care less, or he wasn't impressed, like. And Tommy would imitate him. My parents must have thought that Tommy was going to be the one to go into showbiz, because he was always clowning around. You see the toy gun? It's Barney Jr., right? Well, about this time, Bob Newhart, who we all know and love from TV and film, he caused a sensation in the comedy world because he came out with a comedy album called The Button-Down Mind of Bob Newhart, and it was all comedy monologues on the telephone. This thing shot through the roof. I mean, it was selling like crazy. And the other comedians must have been a little bit envious. They figured, well, I'd like to make a lot of money like Bob Newhart, because they all started making their comedy albums. And Dad had one, too. His was called An Evening with Me. And Al Hirschfeld did the caricature drawing. How many people remember my dad's comedy album? Where are those people I paid to sit in the front row? Well, as you can see, the album didn't sell very well. But it was a very funny album. So one time, Tommy and I, this was in June, Saturday in June, Tommy and I were hanging around the house and trying to figure out what to do for Dad for Father's Day. And Tom just sort of ambled over to the stack of albums. He said, "You know, it's too bad Dad's comedy albums didn't sell very well. He seems kind of upset about that." "Tom, that's what we can do for Father's Day. We'll sell Dad's comedy albums. We'll surprise him." "Can we do that?" "Sure, we sell lemonade, don't we?" "Wow, will he be surprised?" So we loaded the albums into Tom's radio flyer, pulled the wagon down, parked it in a busy intersection, and began hawking the albums. Don Knotts comedy albums, available for the first time on Brand Boulevard, only 25 cents each. That was like a 90% discount. Hey, they're selling like hotcakes. Here you go, ma'am. There's your change. A tip? Here, Tom, put that in the jar. Three albums? Here you go, sir. Thank you. Wow, we're in the money. We're in the money. We're in the money. We got a lot of what it takes to get along. I had spotted Dad's car, scrolling by, screeching to a halt, backing up, and Dad's voice going, "What are you kids doing?" I ran over. "Daddy, Daddy, we sold all your albums, look." He said, "Get in the car, kids, we're going home. I've got to make a phone call." A phone call? Who are you gonna call, Daddy? "I'm gonna call my manager and tell him he's fired. You kids are doing better than he is." Woo! Well, one evening, Dad was watching television at his friend Pat Harrington's house. They had both been on the Steve Allen Show together, which was now canceled, so they were both out of work actors. Dad saw something on TV that made him jump out of the chair. It was his old Broadway buddy, Andy Griffith, starring in a sitcom pilot about a small-town sheriff. Dad couldn't wait to call him on the phone the next day. "Hello, Ange? It's Don. I saw your show. It's terrific. Hey, listen, Ange, could you use a deputy?" Andy just about dropped the phone. He said, "Don, that's brilliant. I didn't know you were available. I'll set up a meeting with exec producer Sheldon Leonard, and you go on in." And that's what he did. So Dad went to that meeting, and he pitched his idea for a nervous but overexcitable deputy, and Barney Fife was bored. Well, Dad worked on that show 5 days a week, sometimes 12 hours a day. By the time he got home from work, Tommy and I were already in bed asleep, but sometimes he'd take us to work with him. I remember that first time I went, "Wow, I love going to the set of Downtown Mayberry, seeing all the familiar stores, but when I go into a building, there's nothing there. They're just fake fronts with window dressing." Why? Like, I kind of thought Mayberry was real. But I love talking to the cast. They're always so warm and welcoming, especially Betty Lynn, Thelma Lou. She always comes over and gives me a big hug. Well, you can see how warm and friendly she is. And I love talking to Ronnie Howard, Opie. He has the reddest hair of any boy I've ever seen. He's so cute. Oh, no, no, I don't have a crush on him or anything. We're both seven, but he's not like the other kids I know. For one thing, he has his own little schoolhouse right on the set and a private teacher to do his bidding. Then I heard a voice. It was a voice I knew and loved. It was Aunt Bee. I turned around. She was smoking a cigarette. I was shocked. I went over to her and I said, "Aunt Bee, you're smoking." And she went, "That's right, kid. I'm still a hot chick." That's not what I was expecting. And then Jim Nabors, Gomer, picked me up over his shoulders. He's really strong, twirled me around. "Wow, I'm above everybody, and I feel like I'm flying." They all thought it was cute, too, except for that time the crew had to clean up after I got sick on the Gomer coaster. Those were my happy days. But fortunately, at home, Dad was still my best buddy. I say fortunately because I didn't have many friends at school. I was kind of weird. When I was a kid, I used to talk to trees, and as a teen, I found myself talking as if I were other people. Dad had this room with a lot of portraits on the wall. They were pictures of actresses he had worked with, was friends with, or just admired. They were mostly women, so I called this room our Hall of Dames. My favorite was the one in the middle, Arlene Dahl. She'd been a pretty big movie star in the 1950s, and I thought, she's so beautiful. She's got it all together. I'll bet she could help me with my problem.
Here I am.
Arlene, you can hear me.
Yes, now how can I help you, Karen, darling?
I want to be beautiful. I want to look like you.
Well, I'm afraid you're out of luck.
Darn. Well, what's the next best thing?
Well, you're intelligent.
No, I'm really not that smart.
Well, then you're a social butterfly.
Well, how do I get out of my cocoon?
Well, then what's wrong with you?
Everything and nothing, I guess.
Karen, darling, when I was barely 17, I had a screen test at Warner Brothers, and on the set I met Carol Reiter, the leading guru of astrologers, and he said to me...
Did somebody call Carol Channing?
Carol, we were not Channing, we were channeling. This is my channel, now go away.
No, honey, go back to PBS. You were doing fine.
And then Dad came up with an idea to help me become popular. He said I should have a party at the house, invite all the kids from school I wanted to get in with, and he would even chaperone with his new wife. Oh yeah, Dad had gotten married again to a beautiful woman named Loralee. Ladies' man, hello. So I passed around some invitations to all the kids at school and told them to invite their friends. I thought this was bound to make me popular. Well, word spread around school about the big bash at Don Knotts' pad, and guess who showed up at the party? Desi Arnaz Jr. I was hoping he was there for me, but he just walked right past me to my dad's liquor cabinet and began emptying its contents into himself. And somebody must have tipped off the high school football team because a bunch of these guys showed up. They stripped down to their suits and ran into the swimming pool. And the neighbors.
That is a stupid story, or my name isn't Carmen Miranda.
Carmen Miranda? I always wondered what it would be like to be you and wear those crazy hats.
Everybody wants to know what it was like in the Hollywood heyday. It was great. You looked at a man and you said, hey!
I wonder if Marilyn can help me with my...
Pardon me for breaking in, but I heard my name mentioned. It's me, Marilyn. And I just want to thank everyone for making me... Oh, that didn't sound right. I want to thank everyone for making me what I am today. That sounded right.
Now listen, Marilyn.
Don't you now, Marilyn, me, Karen.
Stop playing dueling divas at Karen's expense. Karen, I am going to read you your Carmen Miranda rights. You have the right to move your hips and sing a sexy song like this. Boom, chicka, boom, chicka, boom, boom, boom. Boom, chicka, boom, chicka, boom, boom, bang!
As I was saying,
talking about
diamonds.
You should be at MGM, not Warner Brothers, because the lighting is better for your red hair and blue eyes, and they love moles.
Look, all I want to know is, am I ever going to get a cool boyfriend like Desi Arnaz Jr.? Oh. And that's my attempt at morphing multiple personalities. Thank you. Well, all through high school I wore my hair long because that was the style. But then Twiggy came along and changed the style overnight. So when, remember Twiggy? Oh yeah. Well, when I graduated I cut my hair short and Dad didn't like it. He got upset. I think he felt like it was the end of my childhood, and I guess it was really. My first week of college at USC, I felt so independent, and I wanted to get into a sorority. So I was standing in line with a bunch of other girls, waiting to be interviewed to see which sorority would take me. These other girls looked to me like Barbie dolls wearing identical sundresses. Me? I was showing off my best disco outfit and my dance moves. Ha, 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 staying alive, staying alive. Really? Hold that pause. And everybody, you know, noticed me. I thought I was becoming popular, finally. And somebody said, Don Knotts. And said, no, Karen Knotts. And she said, no, over there. And I looked over, and sure enough, there was my father. He had been following me. Well, I know you probably think that's sweet, but in the police car wearing his deputy uniform with a siren blaring? All right, I'm just teasing again. He wasn't driving the squad car. He was driving his white Chrysler Imperial. Dad's career had come a long way since the nervous guy, and he looked every bit like a Hollywood star. I ran over to the car. I said, Dad, what are you doing here? And he explained he just wanted to make sure I was going to be okay my first week on my own. I said, Dad, if I'm on my own, how do I explain you? And he said, well, honey, I know you want to be independent, and that's just fine. But if you ever have a problem, I'm just a phone call away. I'm a Knotts, and that's plural, not possessive. He always knew what to say. I did pretty well in the drama department. I was cast in character roles, comedy parts, even a few leading ladies. But my real training didn't come until a few years after I graduated. Dad asked me if I'd like to go on the road and be in plays with him. Would I? Wow! Our first play together was The Mind with the Dirty Man. Yeah, that was the title. Dad played Wayne Stone, an uptight businessman, and I played Lucretia, a spinstery neighbor who spies on everyone. Now, there was another famous person in this cast, Rue McClanahan from The Golden Girls. She played Dad's put-upon wife, Penelope, and when I saw her in rehearsal, I was just so thrilled, and I finally got up the courage to ask her. I said, Rue, you're a wonderful actress, but I have to know, in real life, are you more like Penelope, or are you more like that saucy Blanche Devereaux? And she said, well, honey, I'm not going to tell you how many men I've dated, but that sign over McDonald's saying the number of people served doesn't even come close. She was great. Oh, it was amazing to be in plays with Dad. He was a master. As much as he loved doing live theater, though, he did not enjoy life on the road. It brought out his neurotic tendencies. But he didn't mind being on the road when he was making movies with Tim Conway, because Tim kept him laughing. Now, to give you an idea how witty Tim Conway is, he recently posted this on his website, and the caption said, here I am in the Apple Dumpling Gang with Don Knotts' stunt double. I do all my own stunts. Now, Disney cast them in a movie and they became a comedy team, but they had very different ways of working. Dad liked to study the script and rehearse. Tim liked to improvise and ad lib. And they were both funny, so they took turns playing straight man. You never knew who was going to deliver the punchline, like the scene from Disney's Hot Lead and Cold Feet.
Sure hate to give a chauffeur a ticket, you know?
Yeah, it's always the jerk in back giving the orders.
Pardon me, sir, You know what that is back there?
Damn right. It's a chimney.
No, no, no. Listen to me. See that dark glass? You know who's behind that glass filming us? Alan Funt. We're on candy camera. Come on. Our chance. Come on, come on. Stand right here. Stand right here. If I can see you. Stand right there. Pardon me, sir. I'd like to see your license, if I might.
No, I never mentioned who directed that film. It was the chimp.